The purpose of telling this story is not to insult any particular religion or to sell a particular fairy tale. The only purpose of telling the story is to give us a sense of real purpose for the gene pool and soul group. You know how we talked about Australia as having a potential role as the crest of the wave of spirituality from the legend of the golden dolphin circling the planet? So the refusion of the soul group could happen here. So Australia gets a little sense of soul purpose. It creates a bit of national identity. Well, now we have the planet. And the planet imagined itself to be an orphan, in that we imagined that the DNA on Earth came from Earth. That was a mistake. Clearly it did not. Some evidence that the DNA on Earth did not come from here include, if you take the Sumerian alphabet, the Sumerian glyph structure, and you shine lasers through them, you fabricate subcellular structures in biophysics. The Sumerian elixirs of the MD microscopist George Merkel in Texas. So clearly, the Sumerian alphabet is an optical waveguide system for creating cellular metabolism. Lots of evidence. Sumerian elixirs. Evidence B, the Hebrew alphabet is the tilt angles of a magnetic domain referenced by the symmetry of the tetrahedron in order to tilt DNA codons into a tetrahelix they call a golem. So that the Hebrew alphabet was a software environment for interventionist genetic engineers. Okay? So these are two examples of the origins of language on this planet being specifically evidence that the origin of culture on this planet was, in fact, interventionist genetic engineering. Now, in fact, the major issue of our soul group today is the fact that our DNA is getting dizzy because our genetic engineers do not understand how to make a soul. This is a problem. So here we are, Groundhog Day. You know, it's like all coming back on us again. Our ancestors hacked up DNA, and that fractionation of their soul group, we're the result of their dream, right? And now we're repeating their mistake. So history condemns is those who do not understand history are condemned to repeat it. So here we are. We must understand the extraterrestrial origins of the DNA here and what the yearning was. And that's what this story is about. Okay. Once upon a time, there were two families of angels. We'll call them the Ophanim and the Seraphim. They said that they chose 1,254 star systems to cast a cat's cradle shadow of themselves in their image and likeness here. The physics of astrology is that the angular arrival of a capacitance wave is how you measure gravity. And so, in fact, the self-similarity of the solar system with respect to the array of those stars created literally a body in their image and likeness. A practical way to measure that is the self-similarity of the Earth's electrical field, which made more gold here than most planets, because gold only happens where ley lines cross in a fractal, and it made the DNA able to become self-aware here more quickly. More fractal you are, more able you're able to unpack awareness. So the solar system had a lot of value according to real estate, location, location, and location. We was fractal. Well, what happened was the Andromedans said, well, why did you deposit those interventionist Alpha Draconis Dracos in our galactic sector since they were so much trouble? And the answer was, the Ophanim and the Seraphim angels had a conversation about designing a gene pool that could be the solution to the angelic dilemma, which was how to fabricate star births with higher leverage, which is angel birth, and literally how to create a level of psychokinesis, literally power, that hasn't existed in gene pools before. And they did this, what they did is they selected a galaxy a long way from downtown and inserted a gene pool which was able to have enough survival urge to be able to make it in such a hostile environment. And that's the group that went to Alpha Draconis. And the group who said they put them there were called the Patal, P-A-A-T-A-A-L, from which comes our word ptah, P-T-A-H, and pterodactyl. Okay? And the Patal were said to be 11th dimensional beings, and you can think of them as bird tribe. And I believe that that story is related that the continuous blackboard here, the continuous family of these gene pools was later described. You have the Ophanim is the Christian word. You have the bird tribe is the Iroquois word. And you have the Adawi is the Cherokee word. And you have the Valnapa, which is the Adnamatna native Australians word, return of the bird tribes, which are the winged ones. And then over on this side, you have the Seraphim. And the Seraphim eventually became the lineage of Mag. And the Seraphim became the Uru. The Uru part of what was later called Nibiru. Right, U-Aru, exactly. Uru means dragon or snake or serpent. The snake gods. Okay, and these, the bird tribe, were called Ibi, from Ibis and Iberia and Geul, which was bird tribe. And when you do the crossing over of these two bloodlines, you get Ibi, Uru, which becomes the word Nibiru and Hebrew. And if you ask a Hebrew rabbi, he will tell you that the word Hebrew means crossing over. Okay, and in fact, on the Uru side, you had a well-developed reptilian brain stem, which was very juicy and useful. Okay, and on the IB side, you had a dog or bird-shaped brain, the dog-bird brain, from which comes our word Dogon and Daganavida. Daganavida, okay? And this becomes the dog bird, and the group that was the characteristic of the dog bird brain is called Wielawa, and you can read about them at wielawa.com, actually. And the story was that the Orion Queen Mag, Seraphims, had won a high percentage of the inhabitable planetoids in the Orion sector, but a truce was called when they realized the dog bird brains, the Wielawa, would accept in marriage an Orion Queen matriarchal telepathic Mag in marriage with each king on a planetoid of the dog bird. This is very ancient galactic history, as told by Robert Morningsky Hopi in the book Guardians of the Grail. So, but this becomes remnant in later history when the Syrian blood behind Jesus Tutankhamun accepts in marriage the dynastic union with the Mag blood, which was said to be the royal families of the Essenes, but the royal family of the Essenes is actually Egyptian, and it's important to know. But that's getting ahead in our story. So, we're trying to get a sense here of what's later described as the war in heaven. What happened was, apparently, A certain portion of this bloodline had begun to use, had come to the belief that you could speed up evolution by mating mechanical structures directly to biological structures. So you have a mechanical bio group called the cyborg. And the Borgs from the Star Trek series have a great historical meaning in the Orion Wars, I believe. And the mechanical biostructures created a fierce survivalistic telepathic group. And they miscalculated how survivalistic and telepathic this group would become. And eventually, they rather took over the Orion sector. The upside of this was they were able to survive better. The downside was they lost passion. They lost glandular passion. And the story of exactly how this happened, which Corinna did at this live King Cobra snake blood ritual with Montauk Chia in Bangkok, basically was, if you see through the snake blood's memory line, you see that there was a drastic war in which the Orion Queen Mag warriors, which I believe at a later time came to be called the Jehovah warriors, Yod-Heh-Vah-Heh warriors, in the Orion Wars, and Enlil took the name Jehovah much later for Yahweh. And so what happened was there was a battle and a nuclear beam hit the portion of the Mog lineage, and what happened was after that, they had two hearts. And the evidence is rather extensive that the Dracos at Montauk and Dulles had two hearts, here and here. Highly telepathic, hard to kill. Very powerful, okay? And this became what later was called the Nephilim. This is the important word here, Nephilim, which is well referred to in Bible and correctly described as the fallen ones, the ones who lost implosion in their DNA and all of the psychokinesis and ensoulment that went with it. So the loss of implosion and ensoulment in DNA became not the whole Seraphim bloodline, but just a branch, a small part of that bloodline fell. But the part of that bloodline that did fall was a big part in the recent genetic engineering in our planet. And the whole Seraphim angelic family is heartbroken about having lost a fractionated piece of their soul group. We're not saying the Seraphim are bad. The word Seraphim here comes from Asaru. Asaru. The Asaru was a name for the Orion Queen warriors, Asa, which then becomes our word Sa-Ra, which we'll see later, means wife of Ra, the sun god. Okay? Well, that's a sort of galactic history. It's a big picture. The Empire Strikes Back, the whole Orion conflict. Earth's history is just a recent skirmish in the Orion conflict. You can see the result of the Orion conflict by simply looking at the local picture in the galactic sector, and you see the spiral arms of the section of the galaxy around Orion is screwed up. Literally, the stars do not fit a spiral so well. The fabric of time got fractionated because of the Orion Wars. We cannot die. We have seen the starships burning off the shoulders of Orion. Remember Tron? Anybody knows what a Tron is? Tron is one who can remember the phase angle between the circle and the line and thus carry biological memory through time travel interactively. Remember, interactive dynamic time travel is the solution to the arriving predatory ETs at wingmakers.com, which is a site I highly recommend, wingmakers.com, along with lettersfromandromeda.com. The only thing wingmakers.com gets wrong is the source of the BST, blank state technology, interactive dynamic time travel. They regard it as a mechanical problem. It's clearly a psychological problem as well. To get interactive dynamic time traveler literally means you need to be a time lord, right? Able to travel in time interactively. When your DNA goes through the speed of light, it necessarily inhabits time. And the time fabric itself must be fractal, and that was an Ophanic agenda, the repair of the fabric of time, which later becomes a Templar agenda. But we get ahead of our story. The question sort of was, who set up whom here? Gets to be a bit of a catch-22. Let's play with that. Okay, and that's your question, too, in a way. Well, who done it? Well, that's the big picture. That's the Orion Wars. Now let's get local. And by local, let's visit the star Sirius at the time when the Orion sector, Queen Mogs, have run and ruled with terror a high percentage of the inhabitable planetoids. And the regent at that time was a fellow named An, or Antu, from which comes our word Solarion, and Tuatha De Danann, which means the sun gods or the people of the gods. Anu. Anu was the regent and the Syrian sector who was responsible to the Orion contingent, literally equivalent to what was described as the trading houses in Dune. And An had two sons. An's two sons, let's look at him in the center. An's two sons, he had other children, but his two sons were Enki and Enlil. And Enki and Enlil were the brothers of East of Eden, which is the basis of the Arab-Israeli conflict today. And An's two sons had the same dad, but a different mom. The dad was Antu, who was this regent on Sirius. The different mom was the fact that Enki's mother was a high-winged Draco, whose blood has not fallen. Sometimes the word for the winged Draco is called Siakar, and you'll see that in a few places in the literature. And it relates to the Christian word for cherubim. Okay? So at any rate, Enki's mom had winged DNA, and the winged DNA means it's if you're clairvoyant and you look, you see that the arc angle of magnetism leaving their heart appears to have wings. It's implosive. the bird tribes, the winged ones. So Enki had a mom that allowed him to learn the skill of insoling DNA. Now that's not a mystery to you now that we've spent 2 days saying exactly what it means to ensole DNA. Remember, how do you turn lightning into ball lightning? You teach the tornado to eat its own tail, right? Well, that's how you make ensole DNA, and it's how you bring people back from the dead. So later when Enki's kids, which becomes the Jesus Tutankhamun story, you can understand why they only were able to ensole DNA and bring people back from the dead. Whereas Enlil's mom was of the fallen DNA, so Enlil becomes the conservative brother who says, well, we got to follow the rules. And the Orion Empire from which, see, the Orion Empire paid a huge investment for the artificial mining planetoid called Nibiru because they needed the gold powder desperately. Sitchin says they were using the gold to repair the atmosphere of the home planet, which is true, but it's a cover story. The fact is they were eating the gold. And they were eating the gold because they were addicted to the gold powder. It was the only way they could speed up their DNA after they fell, the Nephilim, right? So Enki takes the name Ea, for whom Earth is named. And later he takes the name Adon and Adonai, as Tutankhamun. And Enlil and his lineage is that of Thoth, Hermes, Akhenaten, and Tutankhamun. And the story of Tutankhamun was later lied about, and the myth was changed to the story of Jesus, which is really the story of Tutankhamun. So that lineage there is the bloodline of Enki, whereas Enlil took the name Yahweh and Michael, Mikael. And Mikabo, after Michael, became the word for God in most of the native Indian languages, and Mihabo means literally Enlil. So here you have two arriving brothers along with the sisters Inanna and Ninhursag, and they arrive in this artificial gene splicing planetoid Nibiru, towed into orbit as it were here. And this family called the Anunnaki get really bored and angry having to dig up the gold themselves, so they have to make some gold mining slaves. You heard this story before, and that story becomes Adam and Eve. Basically, what happened is they took Cro-Magnon. First they took, Enki did it, Enlil just copied, but he took Cro-Magnon sperm and put it in an Anunnaki egg, and they made the first, what were called Takadama. Takadama means Borg or donkey from Orion. A tak means Orion, and Adama means donkey or Borg, from which comes the word Adam, as in Adam and Eve. And so these first genetic experiments were not fertile. This was very crude attempt at cloning. These guys were klutzes, okay? And so when we mistranslate the Sumerian and call it the Bible, in fact, we're describing some very low-level genetic engineering. It ain't anything to be proud of, and they're not proud of it today, I assure you. But just to give you an idea of the shape and appearance of these beings, I'll just show you. I think, did we look the other day at the lion place? Lion path? Lion path, here it is. So here's the Sumerian goddess statue. Okay, also this is Sumerian goddess figures from the Ubaid, but somebody correctly pointed out that these statues are much older than Sumeria. Sumer means more than South Sea. It also means in the lineage of the Merovingians. And this is the interventionist Anunnaki, sometimes called Anuhazi, which relates to our story of Anasazi. And this is the Dracos. So the Draco bloodline from Alpha Draconis, Arrakis was a planet in Alpha Draconis. The star map of Alpha Draconis is at Shenxi in China and Angkor Wat. Okay? So here you have the interventionist Draco, and here you have the crossbreed Anuhazi, and here you have the winged Draco Siakar. And here you have the Sumerian goddess statue. Now here's the morph. So here is straight out of the drawings of actual witnesses at Montauk and Dulce and elsewhere of the Alpha Draconis. This is from Anna Hayes' book, Voyagers. So I'm just giving you an idea that what came to later be called God were literally medium-grade interventionist reptile klutz genetic engineers. I'm sorry, but that's my opinion. Maybe you're not interested in my opinion, but it is my opinion. It's not all of an insult to the origin of our gene pool here. I'm going to hit stop, close this. Why don't you turn the lights back on here? Well, let's go back to the blackboard, okay? So what's happening here is that Enki and Enlil then realize they need a fertile lineage of these Takadama, these genetic experiment. And what they do is they put a Cro-Magnon egg inside an Anunnaki female and use an Anunnaki sperm. And this is the bullet in the furnace. This is the moment at which Enki, Ea, disobeys the Orion laws about what you can and cannot do with DNA. This is a crime punishable by death. He's literally putting the bullet in the furnace because he uses his own DNA. He uses his own sperm. Because when the Orion queen said you could do some genetic experiments here, they very clearly said cross, not branch. X chromosome, Y chromosome. X chromosome could receive a sperm, but Y chromosome couldn't give one because they knew how to fractionate a gene pool. The female could infold, but if the male gave sperm, then the gene pool would fractionate. So this was the rule. But Enki, Ea, An, they were angry in the Orion Wars because the Syrians were stepped on and ruled with terror by these Orion Queen Mogs, which is where the fear of women came from on this planet. This was a matriarchy originally. Remember, this is a huge old story. We're telling only a tiny piece of the story. So Enki uses his sperm, and that's why he's called Ta, P-T-A-H, from Patau. The story was that Sarah, Asa-Ra, wife of Ra, the sun god, and Sarah, coming from Ur was a city in Mesopotamia, so the story is not of one person. That story is a story of a family lineage. The Asaru came from Uru, the snake capital, and to Egypt, and Ptah, Enki, fell in love with Sarah, and Ea, Enki, did fall in love with his own genetic experiments, no question. He had his weaknesses, too. And so he gave sperm to a Asaru, and in the Cro-Magnon egg, he gave sperm in Ninhursag and Inanna, and the child there was Eve or Isis. And that was the first fertile human female. And so what he had done, this is the bullet in the furnace. The bullet in the furnace that's exciting for you and me is in Ea's sperm was some of the high-winged Ophanic DNA. That was highly psychoactive DNA that the whole Orion Syndicate had no idea how explosive this bullet in the furnace was going to become. So the evolution of that DNA, that memory line, that winged one, can grow up in us, and this is the lineage here. This is what became known as the Disposani in the Holy Blood, Holy Grail series of books. This was, now from here on, now you can pick it up with Lawrence Gardner, who tells only the nice side of the Dracos. Lawrence Gardner is the positive public relations for Alpha Draconis. Okay? And the book specifically is Genesis of the Grail Kings. So here he picks up the story now. Cain, which was the success of the genetic experiment of Adam and Eve, from which comes our word king. The children of Cain were Ea Enki's attempt to fractalize a soul group, make DNA that could go back into the stars. Because Ea Enki, if you read the story right, is basically stuck here. If you read the story in Secret Places of the Lion, he's called Merkaba. Ea Enki is Merk in Secret Places of the Lion. He's Muad'Dib in Dune, and he's Luke Skywalker in Star Wars. And in fact, Luke Skywalker wakes up to find that dad is half machine. Darth Vader, right? And Muad'Dib in Dune wakes up to find that dad, Harkonnen, is half machine. Guess what? Dad was half machine, okay? That's the problem here. That's our history. So what happens then is that Ea Enki and his bloodline through Thoth sets up Atlantis, which was called Thule, to try to protect the ensoulment of the bloodline from this lineage here, Enlil, Yahweh, Michael. And this became Amun, from Amun-Ra, which was the name of Yahweh's followers in the early Egypt. And this is why Tutankhaton was forced to take the name Tutankhamun, because his dad, Akhenaten, had to run for his life in the deserts when he tries to boot the Amun-Ra priests and Lil's followers out of Egypt. And so when Akhenaten runs for his life in the desert from the priests, Amun-Ra priests, whom he tried to boot out of Egypt, he had to change his name to Moshe, which means son of, which was shortened to the word Moses. But the thing is, Moses got away with the money, made the pharaohs very mad. This is the book Copper Scrolls, the origin of the Essenes in the life of Akhenaten. And so when Tutankhamun goes out to the desert to try to save the life of his father, he gets strung up in a tree. And that was one of the beginnings of the Jesus myth. And you can read the academic justification of the fact that there was no evidence for the life of Jesus in the time of Jerusalem at all in the book Out of Egypt, and also the book House of the Messiah. So clearly the confusion over the Jesus myth is an intentional confusion right here in the Yahweh lineage, who does not want you to know that all of the royal families of this lineage, which became the flagship of Hebrew, all of the royal families came from the blood of Enki, because only Enki could ensoul DNA. So Abram, Abraham, and Sarah had the children, Joseph and Benjamin, the second generation. And the house of Benjamin was the house of Magdalene, and the house of Joseph was the house of Tutankhamun. This was Yusuf, actually, which became the house of Tutankhamun, which was later called Jesus. And Tutankhamun's partner, Oxenpaten, becomes Magdalene, and you can see the alabaster jars in the cartouche in Egypt. That's all in the books. What it is here is you have a lineage which has taken the view that only obeying the rules about hygiene for DNA can keep the family group intact. Because this group here basically has no skill to ensoul their own DNA. So naturally they would be susceptible to all the addictives that actually create sustainable DNA. This group believes in external sources of fire. Okay, so from that point of view, they have no choice but to actually use the only good DNA around, which came from Enki. And Michael became a dragon slayer, literally, because Michael was trying to slay the winged Dracos, who was Enki's mother. Okay, and Mikael means from the black hole into God. It has to do with the word for alchemy. It's another story. So the bird tribe is the remnant winged high form of the DNA in Enki. So the return of the bird tribe is literally the story of the return of Enki, which is the title of my new book and the title of Zechariah Sitchin's new book. So where's the serpents and the birds cross? The serpents and the birds cross right here, EB and Uru. The high form of the serpent DNA, Uru, Kumara, for example, means Draco, dragon, or serpent in South America, Sana Kumara. And the EB is Ibis Iberia bird train. The Uru is the evolution of the reptilian brain stem. The mouth of Uru, the mouth of the reptilian brain stem, is called amygdala. A-M-Y, amygdala, which means amygdala. And the shape of the amygdala is a half of an almond. The name of Mandelbrot means almond bread, right? And so the amygdala is the place where the serpent brain dumps the testosterone poisoning into the bird brain. So at that point, if the bird brain can hold the serpent brain in a vice-like grip of a raptor, then the reptilian brainstem can dump its juice into the high bird brain, and the serpent feeds the eagle, and Quetzalcoatl returns. That's the point. That is the point. That's the only point. We have these qualities within us. We have met and encountered the enemy, and it is us, said Pogo, right? Well, we have a conflict. We have a conflict in Israel, and here you have the people that did not know how to ignite their own fire, gathering like a hive mind around the little remnant source of fire that's still there, the Dome of the Rock, etc., Solomon's Temple, were all names for the geometry necessary to ignite fire magnetically, trying to make a hive that could redeem this DNA. Because remember, these fallen interventionist Draco is now, after they shut off the time doors at Montauk and Incunabula and places like that, there was no place for them to go. They're stuck here. So they're stuck here with their own genetic creations. And the sun is about to burp, which means the people who can't time travel without heavy metal are just as bad as a vampire getting toasted in sunlight. Oops. And it's those are the same reincarnates who put up HARP to try to create an isolationist cocoon in the solar maxima. They're the same ones who cost the atmosphere on Mars. It's a recurrent attempt to create a fractionation in the fabric of time to isolate those whose DNA cannot get up to speed enough to go into the stars. So that controversy plays out here on Earth between those who will and will not take responsibility for the direction of DNA. So basically, by making the choice where you're going to take responsibility for the direction of your own DNA, you essentially vote in these Orion Wars, which on Earth is called Arab Israel, but it's a microcosm of a bigger conflict. The Greys, or the Kumar, of which there were many different species, came from Zeta Reticuli, and they had suffered under the genetic engineering of the Alpha Draconis here centuries ago, actually millennia ago. So the Greys were at the stool pigeons of Alpha Draconis here. So for example, when they said the Greys tricked Eisenhower and Truman into accepting abductions after World War II, here's Eisenhower, right? He just won World War II, and then they staged a show for him, showing them that the Greys, ETs, could swat his best aircraft like flies, right? So Eisenhower had such a huge ego, he couldn't admit to the world that he won World War II and lost to the ETs. So instead, he signs on the dotted line and says, okay, you can do abductions. And a few months later, he finds all his best military leaders have been shape-shifted out. There's a detail.
I was gonna say, can you comment on David Icke?
Yeah, I think David Icke is right. I think if you take David Icke and Gardner together, you get a little picture there. And the Montauk survivors, right? The worst thing to do is ignore it. That you should not do. That to me, that's head in the sand, kids. It ain't appropriate, right? So what happens is here, the Greys used, the Dracos used the Greys as kind of stool pigeons to trick Eisenhower and Truman into accepting that treaty. The Draco who was in charge supposedly was a guy named Typhon, which you can read a book about in the book called Geneset in the Holy Blood, Holy Grail series. The other Draco that was involved later was named Charlie. He was the one who ran the Montauk thing. And they were abducting teenagers to steer the time chair. Very educational piece of the puzzle there. Why did the Dracos from Alpha Draconis need human teenagers to steer the time chair at Montauk? Anybody know? Pardon? Well, organ energy? It had to do with the fact that precisely the inability to have DNA that's up to speed enough to travel in time is their soul group fractionation problem. Their fallen DNA, lack of ensoulment, meant that they could not steer the time chair. In fact, the name for the guy that could steer the time chair at Montauk, and all he did is he sat inside a big capacitor that looked like this, called the Deca-Delta antenna. You sit inside a capacitor like this, and the acceleration is called time travel. Well, the guy that sat in there to steer was called the time empath. So it is empathy that sucked into you through the speed of light the experience in time. And the empath is the one who had the most empathy. Well, they could predict in advance which teenagers they could abduct to steer the time chair by doing a spectrum analysis of their DNA, which is what I propose we do to prove to the genetic engineers they're costing our children their soul. And that spectrum analysis was called a boson 7 frequency signature, which was a log function of 7 in the braiding algorithm of the DNA that indicated the high gene for bliss. And so you could tell in advance who could travel in time and not come back scrambled eggs, right? So from this point of view, a lot of the religious experience on Earth is mostly an astral milk house, yeah? And that many people think, well, if I went to church and I got my astral juices sucked out of me, I did a service. Not necessarily, right? It's when you can steer your own astral bliss and take responsibility for the direction for that, that you're no longer susceptible to parasites. So this is the whole little piece of the puzzle, little brief summary overview now of a picture that brings us up to the present time. So what happens? Well, the lineage of Tutankhamun, later called Jesus, was a the bloodline of Thoth, who had a Nubian dark blue blood from Rigel in Orion, actually. And Thoth's children, through what was later called Jesus and Magdalene, become the royal families of Europe for maybe a thousand years. That's called Holy Blood, Holy Grail. So in effect, this Alpha Draconis family is breeding our royal families like we were show dogs for 2,000 years, right? Not necessarily an insult to us, just interesting, right? Well, what happens is the blue blood of the Mag lineage becomes the story of Black Madonna in southern France, yeah, where the Marys went after the Jesus Tutankhamun story was over. And that lineage of those blue bloods, they used copper to hold oxygen in their blood more than the iron. The original story was that the blood was chlorophyll green-blazed, and then when they were forced underground by an earlier nuclear catastrophe here described in the Vedas, that some of them went underground and used iron to hold oxygen in the blood, Scandinavia, Iron Man, Adamic race, the red race, whereas the remnant humanoids at that time went to Sirius and Pleiades, and it's from there that we get this On bloodline. And there they used more copper than iron to hold oxygen in blood and became the blue bloods. And what's interesting is the blue bloods wanted lower oxygen in their atmosphere than the red bloods. And so during a certain time in the Orion Wars, it was literally called the Oxygen Wars because the reptilian shapeshifters can't handle high oxygen in their environment. I specifically recommend that you pass a law that all voting done in your Congress happen in an atmosphere higher than 15 to 18% oxygen, because all the reptilian shapeshifters would be out of your senators. Okay? It's very simple. It's very simple. Yeah? And so very few people know this. But the physics is the fact that high oxygen is a way to select for high-grade DNA, because low-grade DNA, as we say, cannot withstand the presence of implosion. Finishing the story, so the remnants of the Templars, which was an organization set up to worship Magdalene, which was basically honoring the dragon line, okay, founds this Gothic cathedral array honoring the tantric swoon of Magdalene, and the day the largest navy on the planet disappears under the skull and bones crossbone, which is the skull and bones of Magdalene. Remember, this Orion Queen syndicate used a skull touch, a capacitive spark gap between skulls, to convey long-term memory when the Hive Queen would pass on the lineage. And this became the rite of Baphomet of the Templars. Well, the Skull and Bones Navy was the largest on the planet, and they had invented, quote-unquote, insurance and banking on this planet. Whereas, in fact, the Mag Orion contingent had used insurance and banking. This contingent had used insurance and banking to parasitize hundreds of planets. It wasn't invented on Earth at all. The point is that the Skull and Bones Navy, the largest on the planet, that invented insurance and banking, which paid for the Gothic cathedrals, did the same activity then under the pirate's flagship, the same Skull and Bones. And if you give insurance and banking bad public relations, it's called piracy and extortion. But it's the same activity, or the industry of fear in that sense, right? So this then becomes the story of Holy Grail across the Atlantic, origin of navigating by the stars, and the final book, Pandora's Box, which is how the children of Magdalene and Jesus, Tutankhamun, Oxenpaten become the royal families of England, France, and Russia. And the royal family of England, then after Louis the 15th, comes to America under the name Daniel Pasteur, settles at the tailbone of the eagle, finances the railroad cartel, and becomes the Rockefellers. There's several hundred pages of documentation. And of course, the railroad cartel would be a way you could create hive mind, because you'd short out magnetic lines. And the Archons was a name for the winged An, Archon, which became the word Arkansas. And Ozarks were literally the Ozark Mountains. And the Archons at Arkansas, the Rockefellers there, was the bloodline, the illegitimate son of Winthrop Rockefeller, which is the story of Clinton, I believe. And you see the story kind of come up into the present. So the skull and bones of that was the CIA were always, in the case of the pirates and the Templars, we're always concerned with the drug cartel because it was regulating access to the corridors of psychokinesis in the magnetic wormholes of the planet. So this origin of the CIA with the skull and bones and the drug cartel, you get the kind of a picture here that there's an interventionist agenda that begins to fall apart at the moment you realize that only high-quality DNA can survive compression. So now with the onset of the solar maxima, there's a ring pass knot here. The end of the story is that between now and 2012, with lots of fire, even 2004, 2006, you have the solar maxima, the rapture we've been discussing. And that experience is a compression wave that essentially tests DNA for compressibility. And the survival of that compression, similar to surviving death, occurs to those who get the hygiene necessary to achieve charge density. Remember, charge density and non-destructive compression are identical. So the act of preparing to die is the same as the activity of preparing for the solar maxima. The magnetism in your backyard is not fractal, then under the conditions of compression, it will generate heat. So cities whose magnetic lines are not fractal will generate so much heat that the people will go rapidly insane in them. And so this process of preparing for compression is an appropriate way to find out what elements of the gene pools have star inhabiting capabilities and thus are able to be saved or harvested or really graduate into star inhabiting. And so that's the kind of suggestion here, is that here's a little, obviously, remember I said I was about to tell you a fairy tale. I'm not trying to sell you the fairy tale. I don't care if you're even interested in the fairy tale. It's fun. What does matter is if you accept the homework. The homework is to take responsibility for the direction of your bliss juices with the acknowledgement that this is a solution not just to a galactic controversy, but the solution to star inhabiting and the evolution of gene pools in general. There are many stories from several sources that the interventionist ETs have told, the non-interventionist ET families in general are divided, and most people agree on this, from Prism of Lara to Morning Sky to Sitchin, whatever, that the ET families can be divided into the interventionists and the non-interventionists. The non-interventionists are ones who believe that indigenous gene pools must be set free if they're ever to evolve. And the non-interventionist gene pools supposedly include Sirius A, Andromeda, Procyon, Tau Ceti, and some of the Cassiopeian story. The interventionists include Alpha Draconis, Sirius B, Rigelians to some extent, and others. Summary of that at lettersfromandromeda.com. So which groups were responsible for trying to prop up our ecosystem? But they do say repeatedly that they've sort of passed a law that the interventionist ETs will be essentially kicked out of here by the galactic government within a few years. And so the present conflict, which is predicted, we're going to see a major upwelling of in global trauma within months, because this is the last stand of those interventionist ETs who are trying to make their last gasp at having control of the genetic library here. I do think loss of individual freedom is a major catastrophe to the possibility of bliss, and setting people free is the opposite of everything is under control, we have a plan for everything. Okay, that mentality, like in the European Union now, it's illegal to have one employee pick up a cement block. It's against the law. They have planned everything. You must have two. So you can't fart without a permit, right? So this is a planet on which freedom is no longer possible. And that is something to rebel against, in my view. And I'm here. A story I thought I'd begin with, for fun, was when we came out here, Noah, what did Noah say about the dude?
Oh, we're walking the dewdrops, and it had the starlight on it all night. So we absorb it into our skin, all this starlight.
That would really, it's perfect for the theme of the day, because does anybody know the alchemical function of dew, D-E-W, what it's used for in alchemy? It has a very specific...
Rabbits like it.
rabbits like it, yeah.
Must do them for that.
Well, my initials are D-E-W, so I get a little defensive on this.
Somebody says we don't want any dew around here. Automatic bad reaction.
Yeah, dew, drop in, you know, right.
Walk on the dew.
Yeah, you don't like getting walked on.
Is anybody familiar with the starlight elixirs from Hilarion, Pegasus Press? Mm-hmm. So they focus starlight into ordered water, and then they use that water to drink the memory of the civilization on that star and the effect of that star on the Earth. And they literally focus the starlight through a telescope into that water, and the water absorbs the electrical geometry of that star.
And the book Starlight Elixirs is a review of the psychological evolution of hundreds of star systems. So, in fact, it's quite clear that whenever you get a nice spherical little capacitor, like a dewdrop, you have a way of selecting and focusing starlight. Well, you're probably not familiar with the work of Greg Hodowanik and Bill Ramsey, but it's rather famous in psychotronic circles, where they showed that a what's called a passive nonlinear dielectric capacitor, it's basically the same kind of capacitor you see in there where I take hemp fibers to measure life force. And when it's seated in a place which is magnetically pristine, and they just use something called a rust track recorder to make a graph of the change in output charge of that capacitor over time. Nothing is triggering it except gravity. And these devices, the rust track recorders, if you ever saw the plots from these things, when Jupiter squares Saturn, it's amazing. Okay, and so there's a whole series of literature about this, which is effectively that a better way to watch stars is through capacitors than telescopes. And the CIA does not want you to know that capacitance can be focused like a lens, because that would mean all the investment in hiding a stealth aircraft to be wasted. But the fact is, charge can be focused like a lens, and that's what gravity does.
And through hemp?
Well, any biological capacitor. It's basically just a way of catching charge. So here you have this model. First of all, Hodowanik and Ramsey showed that the charge density moves literally measurably faster than the speed of light. So when you had these stellar explosions, and there's charts showing it, where a telescope has to wait 3 days for the light to get here, the capacitor didn't wait. No. And all these astrological events, then astronomic events, were mapped with charge. Right? So this is the Hodowanik-Ramsey work. It's pretty famous in some circles. So what is this telling us about the alchemical function of dew? Yeah, see, the theme of today, actually this morning for a while, is around this question of what turns planets green. That is our little theme, our bumper sticker for some conversation here. And so in order to understand what turns planets green, what puts moss on the sphere, atmosphere, get it? Mm-hmm. Right, what gives us atmosphere, is the same thing that literally puts moss on a stone. It's called the green stone. Has anybody seen the green stone film in the UK? A famous book, The Green Stone, by Phil Squires and Elaine Verlag, I think? The Green Stone in UK, and they started making a movie about it. And it's a book about this stone that has all these powers. Well, in effect, the miracle of the green stone is the fact that it has enough charge to orient magnetism into life. I came out of the door at Adrian's this morning, and there was a yellow flower, and I noticed that the petals of the flower were exquisitely pentagonal. And I put my hand over the flower, and I felt a wave of radiating bliss going through my body, like I often do when I smell a flower. But I didn't smell it. I only felt the charge radiating from the flower. And I thought, somebody steered magnetism into a tornado, yeah? And somebody planted the seed of that tornado, and that's the geometry of charge that steered the water coming from the stone, which we called green. Yeah? It's like when we saw these slides of the tree, somebody brought the pictures of the tree that turned in a corkscrew because the underground magnetism went in a spiral. So biological intention plants the seed here for shaping magnetism so that the planet could turn green. We talked about angelic intentions yesterday in shaping a planet that could have a gene pool that become more self-aware than had happened in the stars in a long time. Now, the alchemical function of dew. You take this thing called the Philosopher's Stone. Anybody know what the Philosopher's Stone is made of?
Magnetite?
No, the Philosopher's Stone is a variation on phosphorus, I believe, isn't it? Does anybody remember? It's, what do you coat the Philosopher's Stone with? A thin film of mercury. Mm. Now, mercury has the atomic mass of gold at the nuclear level, but the valence structure is different, basically. And the phosphorus and the components of the stone have the valence shape of gold, but not the nuclear geometry of gold. Now, if you got a thin film of mercury on the Philosopher's Stone, what would turn it to gold? First of all, you'd need something to make it into a monoatomic layer so the charge could radiate through it. If anybody's familiar with the literature, we're talking about alchemy now because it's a model for the heart of gold and what turns a planet green. The word alchemy comes from alchem, chem, C-H-E-M, chem, is from the Egyptian. It's the original name for Egypt, and it means literally from the blackness, and it's the word for black. And alchemy then literally means from the black hole, which is our word for chemistry. So it's a way of navigating in and out of black holes. That's what alchemy is, which is literally how you get pressure through the speed of light in and out of a black hole. And gold is exquisite at doing that because the electron shell geometry is so fractal, so self-similar, so embedded. So literally, when the waves of charge are braided through gold, they're braided into a fractal, and they're able to enter and leave a black hole. This can be evidenced in modern chemistry from the literature that shows that if you take gold in a monofilament, like a thread, and if you shoot high amperage through it at the moment it crystallizes, it is a measurable superconductor.
The moment it crystallizes.
So in other words, you got this gold monofilament, and you shoot high amperage through it just when it's going from the liquid to the crystal state. The high amperage persuades the molecular array to orient in perfect fractal array. You can model superconductivity by taking the Bucky Fuller vector flexor and jitterbugging it from icosa to cubocta, which is literally what molecules do to become a superconductor. And why are they a superconductor? Because when they assume the icosa-dodeca symmetry, the blue model in there, electrical interference goes to zero because there's an implosive way through the center called access to the black hole, alchemy, because the waves can add and multiply in that spin path. So if you take this gold monofilament and you measure that the electromagnetism can be conducted with zero resistance through it, high amperage, zero resistance, and also it is measurably superluminal, you can take that gold monofilament and you can weld one end of it to a DNA helix and it'll do the same thing. This was presented at the first International Symposium on Nonlinear Energy Device Technologies, Hathaway and...
So wait a minute, you can weld that to DNA?
That's what they're saying, telling us.
What?
Gold monofilament can be welded to the end of a DNA filament. Welded in the sense of a fusion generated by heat, that they'll phase lock.
Wow.
So we have our mold.
So, well, what we have is an understanding. You know, we can get into the politics of welding, you know, mechanical structures to biological structures and where the board came from. And it's an interesting conversation. But you can see where our ancestors, when they lost the ability to spin DNA for themselves, they started using gold.
Mm.
So now, let's get back to the alchemical function of dew. So what you have with dew is, you have an evoked potential, a charge envelope, which has stored exquisite fractal symmetry, because the reason the Earth is fertile for consciousness and gold is because it's fractally arranged with respect to the geometry of stars. That's how our story began yesterday. 1,254 star systems, angelic bodies, cast a cat's cradle shadow of themselves in their own image and likeness. So in effect, what the dewdrop, by storing the angle of the position of each star at the moment of birth, the physics of astrology goes like this. Supposing you were a silicon dioxide and you were about to go from the liquid to crystal state. In the liquid state, at the certain moment, you phase lock and make a bond, and then you're called quartz, right? Mm-hmm. Now, one time I went to this lab in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, where they're making quartz crystal oscillators. Now, we're trying to understand the physics of astrology and birth here.
Making or growing?
They were growing.
Right.
So they'd take a wafer of quartz crystal, and they'd stick it in a large cooking pot, and they'd cook what they called lumber, which were these quartz crystal rods this long. Incredibly pure and clean looking, very gorgeous. And when you'd hold them, you'd think, oh, is this a spiritual crystal? And you know what they felt like? Somebody said, they feel like pâté foie goose liver, where the goose has been stuffed. mechanically. Mm. Yeah. Now, what is the physics? The physics is that the bonds have grown at a rate which did not allow them to collect the charge radiance geometry of the positions of stars in proper time. So here's how it works. This will help you understand why the moment of birth, actually it's the moment of first breath, is that when the liquid is wandering around looking for a place to depose itself at the deposition plane of the crystal, there's a moment when the liquid says, oh, if I orient myself just so, then I can phase lock ionic covalent such that the electron shell's wave can dance where the one wave coming from one end perfectly meets the wave coming from the other end, and that phase lock is called bonding. All bonding is phase locking, whether ionic or covalent. The difference between ionic and covalent bond is whether the wavelength is a short wave or a long wave. Does anybody know which is which?
Ionic short, covalent long?
Covalent means the electron shell level. Ionic means, which is more shared molecularly, ionic is at the individual ion level, which is the atomic level. Mm-hmm. So in either case, the moment of bonding is a phase lock. It's literally the violin string that learns that when you bounce the wave from one end to the other, if the wave comes back upon itself and meets itself perfectly halfway, scenes from a marriage, as it were, you get this phase lock called bond. Now, where in there would there be room for the physics of astrology? Because each time the phase lock occurs, you get a freezing in time of a geometry of a spark gap of a capacitive square wave. So the frequency signature of that one individual bond, because it could be an infinite Fourier series, could have an infinite number of sine waves of charge that met at that one place at the moment the bond was born. So in effect, what you have is a three-dimensional mapping, because remember, astrology is traveling as a capacitive wave. At the moment of the birth of the bond, the liquid molecule gets steered into the bond because of the ambient charge, called astrology. So remember when Bill Tiller said, oh, it's not curly in photography, it's not a miracle, it's a capacitor. Mm-hmm. It is a miracle and it's a capacitor. That's the point.
And it's faster than the speed of light.
Exactly.
So it's all held in that water that has memory.
That moment of that bond. So the infinite Fourier series of the moment of the birth of that bond is a map, is a three-dimensional harmonic analysis map of where all the stars were at the moment of the birth of that bond.
Wow, all that in one dewdrop.
In one dewdrop.
Whoa.
And so then the quartz lumber that was grown in the laboratory, because the number of stars that agreed to form those bonds were artificially mechanically pressurized, the bond geometry did not hold enough contiguous star memory. Where does the role of biological intent come in the role of the formation of the bond? So I was making this film with Don Lorimer, who's called Mr. Magnets. The film was called Magnets and Healing. And at the end of making the film, Don Lorimer said to me, well, there's one secret we're not going to tell him. So we go through this whole gig about about neodymium boron magnets, and they had this intense magnetic flux densities, and you put the positive end on your thymus and it triggers. Put the negative end on your toothache and the pain is dissipated. Okay, you understand the physics now very well. The negative end of the magnet is flux diverging. If you diverge magnetic flux, it diffuses a tension and thus the pain is reduced in your toothache. But it's also true that the healing rate slows down. Okay, whereas if you take the positive end of the magnet, it is magnetically converging, which is then focusing attention, and the intensity of the pain goes up. That's homeopathic. The homeopathic brags about causing the symptoms to come to focus. So that's the physics of the positive and negative magnet. Well, we're done making this film about magnets and healing. And remember, the conclusion that we kind of draw is that you can use them for short-term allopathic reasons, certain stress, etc. But long-term use may not be empowering unless you do the psychological work to make the magnetism for yourself. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And the real goal of eating a magnetic field is if the information embedded in the flux density is in phase with the Mother Earth. So like the Tesla watch makes 8 hertz, but it's a pacifier with no milk, you know? The same thing with the magnetic field, it doesn't hold the real Earth's phase velocity in it. So the secret at the end of the film that Don Lorimer said, we're not going to tell anybody. He says, if you pass a strong spiritual intention at the moment you're creating the magnet, to answer your question, you actually steer the effect of that magnetism throughout its effective life.
Exactly.
My approach has been, when I walk into an audience of physicists, which I actually frequently do, my first question usually is, who here has had a bliss experience? Yeah? And the ones who have had a bliss experience and can talk about it are the ones that are invited to stay. Yeah? And the ones who have not really don't need a language to talk about bliss because it's not part of their life yet. Right? But fortunately, the majority of them really. So, James?
Just a little anecdote. I lived with Aborigines for a couple of years, and when someone is not physically sick but psychologically disturbed for whatever reason, the elder would give their instruction to
the dewdrop. Dewdrop in? Yes. So how does a dewdrop hold the key to how planets are turned green? Because effectively, the angelic bodies of the stars are making a map of magnetism by using charge to steer it, and that's creating the seed of symmetry, which then unpacks as green-making power.
Could you say that again?
So, in other words, the angles of all the stars are storing a map to self-reference, self-embedding fractality by steering charge at the planet called astrology. And that capacitive geometry plants the seed of symmetry to then steer magnetism into self-similarity, which we call life force. So in effect, now let's look at a stone and what enables a stone to turn green, literally.
Wouldn't any planet today that has water be capable of having storing that energy in the water? Mm-hmm. No.
No.
What you just said then, in the dewdrop, is that what we call or was referred to by most people as the memory of the water?
Well, the memory of the water is its ability to store a charged geometry. That memory is enacted in its ionic and covalent bond structure, which in case of colloidal bonds is braided, and also in what's called the laminar coherence of the foldedness of the layers, which can be measured with light scattering tools, also surface tension and seed germination and specific gravity measures. So all of these tools are telling us that water is a way to store coherence capacitively, molecularly, ionically, in terms of macromolecular braiding. So at many different wavelengths, water is the perfect feminine receptor. That's why water so quickly picks up the shape of the geometry of the electron shells of what it's next to, particularly and more powerfully if what it's next to is a thin film. So if water's in a thin film state, or if it's next to a thin film, like a thin film of gold is magical for water, and a thin film of aluminum is absolutely fatal to the water. Okay? Because when the metal, in the case of the thin film metals, is in the monoatomic layer state, the charge conductivity is mostly a surface phenomena. So monofilament and monoatomic layers are frequently used for superconductive experiments. And the conductivity is a surface phenomena. Why? When you're sending an electron from here to there down a wire, okay, it's not like a row of ping pong balls bounced into each other down the wire. It's a wave traveled along the surface. It's a surface phenomena. But in a sense, all of biology is a surface phenomena. The brain is an example of the nerves trying to create maximization of folded surface. The more folded surface, the more memory.
Is that why water has such a capacity for memory?
That's one way of talking about it.
Yeah.
Its ability to store foldedness, both capacitively and molecularly.
But is there anything better than water for volume of memory?
Well, when water is in the presence of a trace mineral bond, it then becomes, it goes more to that tightrope between liquid and crystal. If the cells are too watery, in a sense you call it AIDS. If the cells are too hard, you call it cancer. biology exists because there is a tightrope between liquid and crystal. And on that tightrope, you get the benefits of both worlds. You get charge distribution, and you get stable storage of memory.
And water's ability to change between those states is...
Right. And that's why in the transition moment is the maximum magic for adding intention.
Yeah. But a crystal would be able to hold more information than a drop of water.
But
more easily retrievable?
A crystal might hold it longer, but would not receive it as well, right?
It'd have to be programmed in.
In other words, once it's a crystal, it's not as receptive. It's just like when you buy an apple, you're purchasing the capacitive field of the place it grew, and that's your food. So the same thing is true of the quartz crystal, right? You're purchasing the charge of where it lived.
That's another reason.
Yes. Well said. So it's another reason for buying and consuming local produce, particularly if you want to have your dream spell affect the climate, because you'll then need to penetrate the local biosphere magnetically with your dreaming, which is a field effect. And in order to do that, you ground it. By walking barefoot on the same earth for 100 generations, then your dreaming genetically penetrates the magnetism of the land to the point of fabricating your climate, which is necessary for steering the sun. Remember when we said that the dolmen, Cydonia and Giza, were planted in such a way that the paramagnetic lens function of a dolmen functioned as a timing weight to modulate the spin rate of the planet to phase lock zodiac and stellar spins, yeah? So that here's the planet spinning, but the planet is now nutating and precessing. And the rate of the nutation with respect to the spin rate and the rate of the nutation with respect to the major stellar gravity locally have to be fractally in phase in order to stabilize gravity. And that's what holds atmosphere. Why does that hold atmosphere? Well, it holds atmosphere because the self-similarity of the, or the fractality, or the embeddedness of the shortwave magnetic spins of the planet are what fabricate gravity in the first place. Remember we said, how fractal or self-similar is the nucleus to the electrons predict how much gravity you get, which is why gold is so heavy. Where at a planetary level, the gravity on the planet is stabilized when the long-wave magnetism of the planet is steered to be in phase with the long-wave spin of the stars. And that phase relationship, when it's superlooping or embedding, stabilizes gravity. That's why in Star Trek IV, when the whales stopped singing, the ETs knew the Earth as a biological structure was dying. Because the whale song circles the planet both in time and in space. And the whale's third and fourth generation finishes the same song they started singing. So it's such a long wave, biologically, that it can modulate or packet switch the thin film ocean piezoelectrically to be a packet switching Moiré diffraction gradient, as it were. And that is how the Earth grid intentionally selects and fabricates viruses.
So the more we cut down old growth forests with these tall trees and pick up the long wave, the more we infect ourselves with our own...
The more the viruses become pathologic. Mm. Because viruses are basically a charge condensation of the Earth grid as a whole. The Earth grid's dodeca as a whole is the same symmetry as a virus. It's just charge compressed. So the Earth grid can't make DNA and viruses that are symbiotic to us if we break up the skin.
So you're saying that some intelligence put these dolmens on Mars and here with the purpose of being able to train this information here for consciousness raising or greening the planet. But if we're in kindergarten so far from downtown, why did they choose here?
There's a fun story. Has anybody ever played the computer software called SimCity and SimEarth? Yeah, you played it. Yeah. It's a fun game. In SimCity, you modulate all the things that affect the life of a city, and you're playing mayor, and you determine whether your city breaks out in a riot or survives, right? Well, in SimEarth, they went to a lot of trouble to create a computer simulation of all the factors that determine whether Earth lives or dies. So, for example, in SimEarth, you can adjust the albedo rate of reflectivity of clouds to determine the percentage of heat that clouds reflect back into the atmosphere versus the Earth, and the spin rate, and the O2 rate, and the carbon rate, and the number of dinosaurs you plant, and how many tectonic plates you have. I mean, you can adjust anything And the whole thing just quivers when you adjust anything, and you look to see, did life get born, right? It's a very cool, I recommend it, Sim Earth, lovely tape. Well, a gentleman named Lovelock, who wrote the book, The Gaia Hypothesis, wrote the part of the software for Sim Earth that modeled in mathematics the effect of placing dolmen on planets. So now here you are in a software environment, the latest high-tech science, with Lovelock, who wrote the Gaia Hypothesis, writing the code which controls what happens when you put a dolmen on your planet in this computer modeling environment. Now you know what the software does? If you don't plant any dolmen on your planet, and remember what a dolmen is a big stone, but it's planted in such a way that it's a magnetic lens to steer magnetism into pretty pictures, which we then call life. So if you steer your magnetism into pretty pictures with dolmen, it's like tuning timing weights to make rose petal patterns out of the magnetism on planets, to make them green. Well, in the code that Lovelock wrote, if you don't plant any dolmen, self-awareness occurs very slowly, if at all. But if you plant too many dolmen, self-awareness occurs a bit prematurely, and your planet is rather over likely to burn out its resources before the gene pool gravitates to star navigating. So effectively, he said, dolmens speed up the rate of conscious evolution, but there's a risk. And the risk is essentially burnout.
So the Washington Monument in Washington, D.C. might be...
Well, the story there is that the Masons, following the Templar agenda, which is the Mag Orion group, basically, the Nine, if you believe the story of Puharic, had intended that Washington be the Masonic example of the place where the starseed remnant could build a body polis to create gene pools with enough bliss to redo the star inhabiting and repair the fractionated gene pool. All the king's horses, Humpty Dumpty, that story. But the story was that the Masons intentionally did not place the chief headstone in place, the Resh pillar. So Washington is a fractal without a seed crystal. That's the story. Because they knew implicitly that there was not enough pure intention yet to inhabit the fractal.
Just like the cathedral's not built yet in Canberra.
The seed crystal's not there. And in fact, if you look in Washington at a phenomena when you compress a fractal, if it's not fractal enough, the electrical branching structure, which is called a bush, will burn. So you get to have a near-death experience. You look at that any way you like. But so effectively, you have a situation where planets are turned green by the activity of planting magnetism in a symmetry. Now let's apply this to, there's a book called The Survival of Civilization. Anybody know it? By Haymaker and Weaver. It's basically the Bible of the remineralization people. Has anybody ever met a rock dust person? Basically, rock dust people are going around, instead of saying save the whales, they're saying save the humans, use rock dust. Okay? And effectively, the book Survival of Civilization is interesting, and it's a very important metaphor for what we're talking about, what turns planets green. The essential hypothesis of the book is that the rate at which carbon builds up in the atmosphere, CO2, creates a weight imbalance which increases the rate at which water is precipitated on the poles, creating a squeeze event which causes the tectonic plates to destabilize and the pole flip. So he's saying basically, if you get too much carbon dioxide in your air, then the moisture buildup at the poles changes, and that change of mass at the poles destabilizes the planet, you get a pole shift. So he's saying this migration is where the first you have a CO2 buildup, and then the poles get too heavy and then too light, and then the planet as a spinning top flips over. And he's saying that this is the motor for volcanism. Volcanism is what keeps volcanoes going. What keeps volcanoes going is change in pressure on the tectonic plates, like dumpling in a bowl of gravy. And this change of mechanical stricture there actually creates a piezoelectric force which makes volcanoes go.
But
So the rock powder story is basically where this is at. And what is the role of the rock powder story in learning the star intention of keeping planets green? Well, the thesis of the book was that the volcanoes keep a planet green because they grind the rocks. Very simple. Now, what is the role of grinding up rocks do? Grinding up rocks makes trace minerals available to solubility in plants. And what is a trace mineral? A trace mineral is the memory of the shape of the fire of old stars. So if you have only young stars in your neighborhood, you don't get trace minerals. And therefore, you don't get the complex geometries to organize water into ice 9, to go from liquid to crystal. Yes?
I saw some minerals, but they're from the ocean. Mm-hmm. As a result of the evaporation and the salt being removed, and then you sell the all the minerals. So would that have the same...
Well, what would be an interesting experiment to compare the relative rate of soluble availability to sell to plant life, which is interesting, which is why they say that rock powders that have sat underwater for a long time do not have the same degree of soluble mineral. Mm. And soluble mineral, remember, here is an old star, which is literally an old angel. So here's the old angel saying, here's a hint, geometry, geometry, geometry. Okay? And that's what a trace mineral is. Now, does anybody know why the forest, the only green trees in the Black Forest were next to the gravel roads?
Because they were getting the trace minerals.
And why?
Because they were ground up. And...
So you had ground, so how is it mechanically, if you were a biophysicist and had to explain why the only trees in the Black Forest that stayed green in acid rain were the ones next to the gravel roads. The biophysics is that when the trace mineral is leached from the soil surface by the rain acidity, the pine needle, let's take the pine tree for a moment, the pine needle does not have trace mineral in the water. The trace mineral in the water of the pine needle is what teaches the water molecules to organize themselves into ice 9 because of the geometry. So the geometry of the trace mineral is the cookie cutter for molecules to arrange themselves into a nest so that literally the water in the pine needle is more orderly than ice, literally. This is called Albert Szent-Györgyi's Electronic Biology in Cancer from Woods Hole Marine Biological Laboratories, Nobel Laureate Prize-winning work on the electrical origins of cancer based on the organizing of water to propagate what's called the triplet state electron, which is simply an electron that has so much extended family that billions of molecules can hear about that electron's story. Extended family for kids is how you make avatars, right? So orderly water allows distribution of charge. What's really happening here then, the pine needle turned brown because the cell ruptured because the water was not more orderly than ice because of the absence of trace mineral. So the geometry of the trace mineral has to find a way to radiate into water. So here's the physics. The old wives' tale says if you drink too much water when you eat, you get arthritis. What's the physics?
You wash it out.
The amount of acidity in digestion determines the charge, which determines the amount of mineral that can stay soluble. So if you reduce the charge, which in this case is the acidity of digestion, the minerals fall out onto your bone. It's called arthritis, right? But what is the relationship then if you have no bliss, if you're depressed all the time, you can't hold mineral because you have no charge. So effectively, it's charge that steers the trace mineral into solution. That process of getting a trace mineral dissolved is the esoteric nature of designing dopants in the theory and design of quartz crystal oscillators, okay? In other words, you got this quartz crystal, and you want to persuade a little bit of trace mineral to tune the thing. The difference between citrine and amethyst is what? Actually, it's heat. What happens is you got a little bit of iron that you persuade to function as a dopant, like one molecule among millions, and because it's at the center of the array, all the capacitive waves have to travel through it, and it becomes the cookie cutter and tuner of the array. So amethyst is said to prevent drunkenness, literally, because the iron is a place to bond oxygen, which holds fire, and mind inhabits fire, so you don't get drunk if you have oxygen, right? Whereas if you deprive the brain of oxygen, you call that drunkenness. Now, if you take amethyst and you heat it slightly, the deformation angle of the SiO2 slinky just does a little ratchet, and the change of bond angle in the helix of the slinky changes it from amethyst to citrine, and you see yellow instead of purple. So the point was the dopant was the trace mineral that steered the crystal around. Well, the trace mineral is the dopant in the water, and the charge is what steered the trace mineral to life, to embed. So the combination of the water plus the capacitance and the trace mineral, three ingredients, plus the right amount of gravity, and your planet can turn green. The thing is, you see, if you get too much atmosphere, I mean, if you get too much gravity, you can hold an atmosphere, but you get no life. If you get too little gravity, life can't happen because you got no atmosphere. And there's another tightrope here. Planets with too much gravity, they get this heavy, ugly atmosphere, but no life. Too little gravity and your atmosphere goes away. And there's a dance, a very, very tricky little dance for modulating that amount of gravity to still have an atmosphere, but not too heavy for life. And that dance is what has to be modulated by Dolman. That's what Dolman do. The biophysics is described to some extent in the book Two Thirds on the Arcturian technique of planet taming for Dolman placement. They called the pyramid the Hummer. They were planning the symmetry of charge to make biology possible, to put atmos on the sphere. My understanding of the Montauk situation was that when Eisenhower and Truman were tricked by the Greys in accepting the treaty to permit abductions, the agent behind the scenes was an ambassador from Draco called Typhon. And that at that time, Eisenhower and Truman were given just enough time travel technology to get in trouble. And that's effectively what became the seed for what von Neumann tried to create, which eventually drove him crazy, nuts. He lost it. Johnny von Neumann, one of the most famous mathematicians in history, was intimately involved. So they designed an electrical circuit, first experiment with it, Philadelphia, which could fold the electric to magnetic vectors back upon each other and create collapse. Now, they didn't barely have a clue as to the real principle of what collapse meant, but they got just a sense that recursive collapse could accelerate biological magnetism through the speed of light into time. And so these stupid dummies. And Tesla, by the way, was smart enough to say, you guys are crazy. You're rushing in where angels fear to tread. I'm out of here. That's what Tesla tells these guys. So anyway, von Neumann, they do this thing, and sure enough, half the sailors get frozen in the hull because they create this acceleration cocoon.
Cameraman might be.
Should we go inside? Yeah.
So did you want to say anything more, Donna, about your experience? About that experience with the Greys, for example?
I'll start from this angle. I started to write a book at work. I worked at a management job that was seasonal. I was told to bring a book to work. I decided to write. It looked like I was busy. It wasn't a professional. I started writing a book for my children on all my experiences.
Experiences with the Greys?
No. My family, my travels.
Oh, your travels, okay.
Lived in a couple of years, all the things I've done. And I got to the end of it, and I read back through, and there was a pattern working through. As I went back through, I found that the things that happened were really all connected. And I'd seen a landed UFO in 1975.
A landed UFO.
In the 60s, I had an experience on a lonely road one night, which resulted in getting home, turning off the car keys, going back to the car to get the keys out, and finding the keys on the back seat, where I felt there was an entity. I was crippled. I almost drove the car off the road. But whether I was abducted up there, I don't know. But going further, I was living in Nepal, and this is the one bit that I think did it for me. I was sitting on the floor blowing up an air mattress for my American partner who just got back to Nepal. He was over quite a distance in this room, and I'm blowing the air mattress up. I had a very quick vision of a very tall yellow being with a black cloak and a black hat on. Just like that. But there was this very weird smell.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
My daughter was conceived that night. There was no other time that she could have been conceived.
Right.
When I did the workshop with people screaming,
yeah.
and he spoke about this. I didn't know about it. Mm. I burst into tears.
Right.
Everyone went, oh, and he went, no, no, I'm feeling his energy. And he went, go with the smell, go with the smell. Now, how did he know there was a smell there that night?
Yeah, great. Credo Mudwa knows the story too. Yeah. Yes. So the other piece of your story that I think the people here might... Yes, go ahead.
Her birth had been predicted.
Her birth
was... I was terrified. It said, if you stay in this house, it was ancient language. It used thee and thy. It gave me her name. My partner wouldn't allow it to be used because we've never heard of it before. It's now her second name. But I was so scared. I actually packed my house and was gone in 2 days because I wasn't ready for a baby.
But the other piece of the puzzle I think people should be aware of just for this conversation is you had some evidence that there was an interesting piece of indigenous blood in your heritage, correct?
I was told that, but we haven't been able to prove it.
Right.
But I have tracked down an elderly relative, and he said that and even my mother said, look, she said, although they're tracking the genealogy, they cannot find an indigenous person. I remember someone saying Black Jack, and this second cousin of hers said, and he's now deceased, he said, you have some Spanish Indian blood, and his wife was German.
So Spanish native blood from probably the Middle Americas or something.
I have no idea.
Yeah.
No one will come up with it, and I haven't tracked it.
Because the report was that up to 90% of the women who experienced abduction-like experiences with the Greys had some indigenous or native blood. And so that's something you always check for. And why were they interested in the psychokinesis of your DNA? In a way, it's an honor, but in another way, it's something they would say maybe there was some soul negotiation beforehand and things like that. Yes?
Well, I know I'm not white.
Right.
I have known from the earliest stage that I'm a black person in a white body.
Mm-hmm.
I've told my mother at the age of 8 or 54, I just know that. I don't even fit in with my siblings.
Mm-hmm. So the alien mutant spore phenomena. Right. Well, feeling black may be associated with Thoth's report of Nubian dark blood, which became the story of the Black Madonna, actually. And the Black Madonna was said to be black. The high copper content of blood combined with what was Nubian, which is the story of the copper content of the Rigelian blood, we're led to believe, which supposedly is the Thoth bloodline, which is a portion of the bloodline of the children of Enki. Because although Enki and Enlil supposedly came from Anunnaki with Assyrian lineage, the origins in Orion for his mother were probably Rigelian. And the Rigelians are described in detail at Montauk. The pyramids of Montauk and the other Montauk books are the source for the information about the Greys and Rigelians. Although I learned about the Rigelians at Montauk from personal conversations with Al Bielek and Michael Ash, who was the chief time empath there. The Rigelians were not regarded as very friendly types, actually, there, but it fits the story very well. The part about Thoth's dark blood in the creation of the Black Madonna lineage through Oxenpotten, later known as Magdalen, was told in William Bueller and Simon and Maya's work out of Crestone, Colorado, which you can read on the web. The links are at soullimitation.com/Bueller, B-U-E-H-L-E-R, where William Bueller's Templar work with Thoth in the repair of Fabric of Time includes many pictures, actually. We could dig those up. I have them handy here if you like. But what I wanted to do was get to try to sort this out now in terms of principles. So where were we? We were telling a story about Montauk, and we're trying to understand the extraterrestrial interest in our DNA, and we might get some clues to your abduction story a little bit, possibly. Not that we can figure it out for ourselves. Obviously, it's for you to understand. But we might have some clues. If we put our heads together, we might trip over something interesting. Well, I personally have, when I lectured in the International Psychotronics Circuits for so many years, I used to sit next to Preston Nichols all the time, the co-author of the Montauk books. Came to know him very well. And then when the teachers from the Ken Page Multidimensional Cellular Healing Group work with Drunvalo were at my farm, Ken Page's group, they had been invited into New York to work with a lot of the Montauk survivors, doing the psychological work to basically dehypnotize them to reassemble their fragmented memory. Because hypnotic memory loss is part of the Manchurian Candidate program, and that's part of what you're experiencing pretty likely is some hypnotic memory loss. And the memory loss can actually be comfortable from the point of view as, well, it prevents you from feeling disturbed about it. But unfortunately, spiritual evolution is, in general, the absence of memory loss, because the more you store something that's not felt, the more you create discontinuity of memory, which is the opposite of consciousness. It literally fractionates awareness. So particularly if there's any peak emotional experiences, good or bad, which you have dissociated from your conscious memory, you actually create a magnetic interruption in the potential for kundalini in your body, literally. So going back to sort out memory loss is a very important thing. And Ken Page's group calls it multidimensional cellular healing. You can find a lot of that on the web. There's an e-group. Just search on Ken Page and multidimensional cellular healing. Well, that group was invited into New York City by the Montauk survivors, and that's how I came to have conversations with Michael Ash, one of the Montauk survivors, who was supposedly one of the chief, what they call time empath, which was, remember, empathy is how you steer yourself in time, because the more you weep and feel for those you're seeing, the more your compassion sucks the magnetism through the speed of light into your body. That's the Nostradamus procedure. Okay? And so what did I learn, or what did we learn about the Montauk experience? And that's where we were when the rain struck. What I learned was, as we said, that von Neumann and Tesla and others were induced by the government to do, at first they called it ship disappearance at Philadelphia, but later, when they set up at Montauk, they used a place which the Montauk Indians for generations had already been using for what was a form of shamanic time travel. So clearly there was some fairly conscious planning about using a place on the grid magnetically where there was already dimpling in place to fabricate this traveling in time, which is just an acceleration phenomena. Supposing you take an antenna of this structure, it's called a decadelta antenna, which is an array of capacitors, you create a compression wave at the center. It became the movie Contact, and also this geometry of compression that accelerates people in time travel. If you set this up at a place where the magnetism in the Earth is already fabricating a bit of a dimple, you create a place where acceleration is more possible. And that's why the grid magnetic lines are so critical to what's called time travel. And this became known as the concept of synchronic lines at Dahm and Herr, for the time travel experiments there. So, pardon? A stargate is another word for it. And all those words simply mean is places where magnetism converges non-destructively. Another practical example of that is if you look at the place where magnetic lines dimple powerfully in Portugal, it's at the Templar stronghold at Sintra, S-I-N-T-R-A, in Portugal. And if you read the article at soulimitation.com/Portugal, you'll see that Sintra in the South American dialects means rabbit hole. And you know what Alice in the Looking Glass and the rabbit hole does? It creates a place where the magnetism dimples and creates this inward folding vortex where you get both acceleration because of compression, which we then call gravity. And when the acceleration goes through the speed of light, the only thing possible is to inhabit time. And if you have the hygiene, the genetic coherence, to be accelerated in that way, you are said to be one of the Els, as in the Elohim, or the Shining Ones. And the name for that at Montauk was Boson 7, which was a frequency signature of the DNA, which when the spectral emission lines had log functions of 7, suggested probably a braiding algorithm in the DNA that indicated the coherence necessary to permit acceleration. Similar to the mitochondrion story in Star Trek, the prequel. What's the name of the young guy? He becomes Hanakin, right? The presence in the blood of coherence field effects, implosion tendencies, are literally a predictor of successful time travel, as well as lucid dreaming. And my guess, dear, is they saw that in you with your ancestry. But my guess also is they saw a certain weakness in the personality, and I would just wonder, Weakness in the sense, for example, tendency to depression, tendency to lack of bliss, something at the time when they first communicate with you which allows them into your aura. Thank you for trusting us, dear.
It's hard. I feel like crying. I've got a kind of vibration up my legs.
Let's be real gentle here. But there is some lessons here. We might be able to learn them gently. One of the reasons it was said that the Greys, the Kumar, came back in time was because they were losing the ability to make an immune system in their own children. And so they needed some of our blood. And some of that was by agreement. But remember, the Greys or the Kumar were actually the subject of genetic manipulation by the Dracos themselves. So they were unwitting stool pigeons in this whole affair, potentially. Yeah? That's the story we're told. And so Whitley Strieber comes to realize some of the self-empowering issues in here, also in his later books. Yes?
Was it also because of some lack of emotionality they wanted to reconnect with?
Well, this is the question. This is our hypothesis now. Have you ever seen a gray that was passionate? Oh, why do we laugh? Yeah? Right? What is there a clue? Is that a clue? Yeah?
Oh, I have seen compassion.
Uh-huh. Yes?
Interestingly, that's all I saw, because that's all I was given, were a pair of golden eyes in the night. I was woken up to witness it. And this actually happened. What came through the eyes, there was nothing there except compassion. It was just, I've never seen it before, just raw compassion. Now, I woke up in the morning, reality woke up, and I got up, went out to my laundry, and I just got the cat food home and started to do my normal routine. And I felt something warm on my arm, my iron was up. I went over to my laundry tub, and there was half a basin of warm water there. Now I'm having
You could have been chosen well in the there's a movie, The Three Witches of Eastwick, and all this.
No,
you could do a very good job, dear.
Can I ask you a question about
Montauk, right. M-O-N-T-A-U-K. Montauk. Yeah, The Pyramids of Montauk by Preston Moon and Peter Nichols. There's a whole series of those books. There's some interesting material in there. What the William Bueller group, the Repair of the Fabric of Time, Thoth group, did say was that the Greys instigated that time travel experiment in part because they realized that as we did that, we'd actually create a tear in the fabric of our own etheric grid. They called it the fabric of time. And unfortunately, that is like somebody who's been maybe doing a few too many drugs and they get holes in their aura and they're subjects to more astral entities coming and going. But they said that in the case of Earth, because of the experiments at Montauk, that happened at a planetary level here, that the electrical aura of the Earth as a whole became more torn, and this permitted more of these astral entities, who are fractionated soul groups, who do not have a way home. No implosion path. The atmosphere falls apart on their home planet. In the case of Grace, that's reticulum. And they discover gradually that they've lost the passion necessary to ignite an immune system in their babies. And so they realize that as a race, they're decaying. So they're trying to fabricate a bloodline that can literally stitch them back together. And they would regard us, particularly those of us who could lucid dream, as a vaccine. Yeah? So the issue is the very weak immune system. And let me guess that probably she hasn't found her passion yet.
I told her to go and roll in the grass and get pollen on her and get things that are natural. get natural elements. I see her maybe being buried in sand and beach and getting covered in mud.
That's the key experience. Precipitate the magnetic turning inside out nest. Kiva, Kipapu. The Kinavata might be a good book about that for her. So what we have here is a situation, is a whole soul group, in this case the Kumar or the Gray, and there are many different levels of them, who lost their planet, their ecosystem, millennia ago, and are literally, along with many other groups in among the stars, looking for a place to get a bloodline necessary to refuse their fractionated soul group. It's another Humpty Dumpty couldn't put the egg back together again. All the king's horses, you know, all the royal blood put together. So the theory here is that the Earth grid, by being so fractal in both space and time, had presented the opportunity to soul groups from around the galaxy to use the genetic library here to refabricate a way for themselves back into the stars. Yes.
It wasn't an accident that we were fractal in space and time.
That's the point. So where we started with the Ophanim Seraphim story yesterday over here was that the intention to create this experiment in the bloodline cross between EB and Uru, which we call a Seraphim versus Ophanim, Sara Asaru, the serrate means to cut. So serrate, the seraphic, sans serif, the font, which is a cookie cutter, is all about cutting. Serrate by phi, cut by phi, Sarah, and this lineage had the potential of being cut by phi, and this is O phi in them, O phanum. This became the bird tribe, the bird brain, and this became the reptilian brain stem. And the experiment in this bloodline cross became called eventually the war in heaven, as described in the Bible. And it's out of this war in heaven, which is essentially about who gets to have the DNA that can steer the stars around. If you remember in Dune, the guild navigators got the privilege of navigating wormholes between stars, and they're the guys that make the big bucks, right? They're the guys that get the high leverage pay scales. So obviously the competition here, when the Orion group discovers the only way they can motorize galactic commerce is with a gravity wormhole, which the Hopis call Peshmaten, is suddenly realizing that gravity wormhole is inhabited, and the guy that lives in there is the real boss. And this is called Deep Space Nine, if you saw the movies. And it's literally the physics of who steers wormholes. And so that's the competition here. The competition is about who grows up to steer the wormholes. They make the big bucks. And so there's a famous novel, it's called The Crystal Singer. And how much you pay the lucid dreamer, because she can steer the shape of your dreaming, right? So those who can steer these magnetic worms through the speed of light into time travel using glandular passion are the ones that have value. And so the genetic library on Earth is this treasure trove of cookbooks for all of these civilizations that are looking to finish off the welding and fusing of their soul groups to enable this high leverage capability. So the competition over good DNA is very intense. It's an intergalactic controversy. The actual humans of Earth are merely pawns in that game in many respects. But one thing we do have going for us is if we recognize how interesting the DNA is inside of us, then we get to at least know what our playing cards are in the poker game. Because believe me, it ain't our technology. Driving around in cars powered by dinosaurs farting and computers that are to them billions of years old and just really pretty childish. Our technology is not what we're supposed to be proud of here. That ain't it. So the ability to make a gland that can radiate a field effect that'll bend something, that's interesting. The ability to switch an emotion on a dime. The ability to hold coherence in the heart. These are skills that have galactic politics implications. So that's what you focus on, developing the life force in your DNA and your glands. So taking your power is also taking responsibility. So if you have taken the responsibility for steering a gravity field, then there's implosion in your heart. And the reason a vampire dies in sunlight is because his DNA, not having its own fire inside, does not have the phase discipline to go through implosion. And therefore, when there's fire in your hearts, the parasites run from your body, and the astral parasites, and the grays who don't have pure intention, they run as well. And then any grays who come up to you and ask for help are going to ask you as an equal. Ultimately, we're learning the principle of steering gene pools into stars to make them green, right? And to create soul groups that become navigable. And the grays encountered this problem a long time before we did, but they're a little bit of a vaccination for us too, because they lost their ecosystem quite clearly. I mean, their ecosystem and atmosphere and their planet went to toast. And then they discovered, well, look, it fractionated our soul group, and look, we're losing our immune systems, and it's a magnetic problem, and it's a DNA problem. And then they began this mechanical recook up the DNA bit and didn't see the psychology of it, the glandular passion role. And I do think they missed that, a lot of them. There's a lot of different levels there. But clearly, that's why I think the Templars are regarding them as secondary to the issue of the Dracos, because the Dracos were the trigger of their problem and ours indirectly. In a certain way, played a parental role to both species. But remember, we've talked a lot about Alpha Draconis, but by no means are we suggesting that's the only ET species that's messed with our DNA. Many reports suggest 22 different ET species have messed with our DNA here, and I tend to believe them. Just in our most recent historical epic, the Sumerian Bible story, has so much to do with Alpha Draconis that it's a fun place to start. But you have all these other, you know, the Arcturian, Andromedan. They all have a stake here, because this was by agreement to have been a genetic library. That means all the local civilizations use their library card. They check in here and check out a little chunk of DNA they need. And so then who gets to run the library is what they squabble about. The humanoid anthropomorphic shape has been taken to be one of the most efficient accelerators of DNA in the stars, as above, so below, in their own image and likeness, the whole thing. So the amount of fractality inherent to the design of human biology is such that if you want to get DNA up to speed, what an efficient shape. It makes a lot of sense. So everybody wants to copy the structure. But that's not something we should be proud of having invented on Earth. The central core cultures knew that long before the DNA templates arrived here in the Egyptian called the Nedirs. The Dalai Lama stories in Tibet are instructive, that he travels in the country, finds a family that strikes his fancy, and that's where he incarnates next time. And the whole country comes to worship whoever can prove that their memory line is continuous. So that's the royal blood is by definition the one who can remember past lives. What's the physics? It's DNA that can compress well. So if your DNA can compress well, and you can do something intentional on that level and bring the memory through, then there's more coherence mathematically between incarnations. But for most people, so for all practical purposes, reincarnation is not real to most people. And even those of us who have fragments of that memory, we need to acknowledge that they are fragments. When you drop a purple ink through a straw into water, and it forms a beautiful purple donut in the water, and then as it decays, you see 7 smaller purple donuts form in the water, if the water is laminar or sacred. The 7 smaller purple donuts will be at the tilt angles of the 7 spins of the tetrahedron in the water. That's the way the Reverend Mothers explained to me the physics of why after every incarnation, 7 will incarnate the memory for the next incarnation. And if it's a great incarnation, it'll be 7 times 7. But they said that typically only 1 will actually accept the soul mission, the purpose. The concept here is from Education of Oversoul 7 by Jane Roberts, that the evolution of souls has some coherence to the extent that our emotions are coherent enough to steer our DNA. Reverend Mothers.
Like the Bene Gesserit.
Ah, see? Very good. We have a clue. Mm-hmm. Then why don't you say who the Bene Gesserit were?
The order of witches from Dune that were able to speak in power language and had this whole order that was
thousands of years old. And that the Hive Queen was a telepath. And they used to track the evolution of bloodlines so they would be aware where the next avatar was going to erupt like a volcano from the bloodline. So they were actually tracking these bloodlines and planning these incarnations. So they're crossing Harkonnen, who's half Borg, with the Reverend Mother in order to make an avatar, Muad'Dib, right? So here you have Enlil gets crossed with, you know, Enki's mother, his father, Enki's father's half machine, An, and his mother is a winged dragon. So they're planning these crosses of bloodline. They're called the Reverend Mothers. Why did I mention the Reverend Mothers telling me? Well, when I moved into Western New York, on the shores of Lake Erie, Erie means nest for eagles, the Erie. It's just above Cleveland, where the land is cleaved. Long story. So I settled in there, and I met this group of women who had one thing in common. They all claimed to remember their incarnation with Jesus in the time of the Essenes. Now, if you read back in my story here, we're saying the Essene story is the refugees from Akhenaten. But in any case, this group of women were tracking bloodlines and memory lines. And they began doing ritual in Pennsylvania. And it was them that actually taught me about that eagle star morph you saw. Remember we animated the eagle on the face in Pennsylvania? Well, the Reverend Mothers and we would charter a bus. And we'd go down there and do these powerful rituals on this land in Pennsylvania. And we were, our assigned task at that point was to assume the threads of the bloodline of the royal family, the Mogs, where the Masons went into what's called the Women in the Wilderness. It was a conscious knowledge that the treasure of Akhenaten, which is the treasure of the temple of the soul of man, Solomon, which what became the wealth of the Templars, came to North America. Later we learn in more detail in the book Pandora's Box through King Louis XVI, who changed his name, Daniel Pacer, and the Rockefeller stories, Tryon, North Carolina, the whole shtick. And so here you have Henry Sinclair, Holy Grail across the Atlantic, his kids come down and inhabit Pennsylvania. And here you have the descendants of Merline, the red-haired Cherokee, they come up, the spine of the eagle. And then here you have the story of Pandora's Box and Daniel Pacer and the origins of the Rockefellers and the Railroad Cartel coming from Tryon. And they all converge in this area called the Keystone State, which is Pennsylvania. Now, Pennsylvania is on a green barrel tectonic plate, which is literally a green stone. It's a cup. The cup is the Georgian Bay, which if you look backwards in time, you see it is the center of the cup of when the tectonic plates were Pangaea, which is the tectonic plates do this. Here's the tectonic plates. They go shoop into a fetus, and then they go shoop, and they unfold again. And when they go shoop into a fetus, it's called Pangaea or Pangaea, and it looks like a baby. The continents do this, and then the continents unpack like a fan around the globe, the tectonics on the dumplings on the bowl of gravy. And so what happens is the tectonic plates unpack and pack. And that's called the Wilson cycles, and it's supposedly in phase with precession. And if you understand metabolizing starlight directly, you understand in the human that the activity of going from here to here is the activity of changing the wavelength of the capacitive waves you eat. When you're at this angle, you're eating short waves. And the more you unpack, it's a longer and longer wave that literally you're metabolizing electrically. So maturity, the ability to be weaned and metabolize starlight directly, happens on an individual level as one human being learns digestion and then learns to digest gravity. And then it happens on a planetary scale as well. This is a For What It's Worth story from the Reverend Mothers. So the Reverend Mother's story was that at the time when the tectonics were in this fetal cup, which we later call Pangaea or Pangaea, that this fella called Merkaba, described well in the book Secret Places of the Lion, later I think it's the same guy as Ea, Enki, got stranded, his craft landed, crashed down, got stuck. Oops. And so basically, this is another way of understanding, the soul group got fractionated here, like our DNA is losing it. It's getting slower and slower. And the last planet we can finally start to navigate to before our DNA slows down altogether is Earth, named after Ea. Okay? And what did they do when they got here? They set up 6 capacitors in a hex, which is the flower of life and the flag of the Dracos and the flag of Israel. And those capacitors in a hexagram were designed specifically to create a charge field which would prevent cellular aging. And that physics was called the Garden of Eden, E-D-I-N, which means spaceport. And to be booted out of the Garden of Eden means you were dumped out of the capacitive field and you'd start to get old. Which, if your DNA is decaying, fallen, Nephilim, that's a problem. So anyway, the story about the Reverend Mothers was that the original, oldest, undisturbed memory exists in that Beryl Greenstone tectonic. And if you talk about this to an archaeological or a geological person, you call it the Ontario Shield, which is a Beryl tectonic plate. And an old greenstone. And it supposedly has the oldest biologically undisturbed memories on the planet. The Reverend Mother said, this is another for what it's worth, Reverend Mother said, remember you saw the star map of the eagle on the state? There's a river, the Susquehanna, that goes from the snake to the birds, right? And the serpent feeds the eagle, and Quetzalcoatl returns. Well, the story was that the juices up the spine would change direction. And the story was that the green stone, the Beryl tectonic, was going to be the cup that runneth over. And there was to be a tilt. And then that river would change direction. And you'd have Kundalini for the tectonic. Huh? Anyway, this was part of the story, the mythology, which the Reverend Mother said was responsible for how the fractionated gene pool would inhabit the star map, get the group bliss, and refuse the soul group, and re-inhabit the stars. This was called the Eagle's Gift. Well, this group, when they got together, it was like kibitzing among midden ants. And I remember once we would sit on the shores of San Francisco Bay talking about growing up with the Jesus, which I think is the Tutankhamun family, like you were aunts and uncles. It was like kibitzing. It was a scream. But one of the things that happened was they became intensely aware of which soul, part of the soul group you came from. For example, they said that I was a reincarnation in part of the Lazarus experience, Lazarus, and that the preparation to survive the death experience was a necessary priming of the pump for the soul group to be able to go through the death experience non-destructively. And they said Lazarus was a bossy uncle of Magdalene who got angry and skipped town and set up a house of prostitution which earned big bucks, which became part of the Magdalene Templar wealth. And this is quite a story. Anyway, they were dubbed the Reverend Mothers by this guy, Bob Gulick, because they were stewarding bloodlines. Anyway, I was excommunicated for the Reverend Mothers, or from the Reverend Mothers. Want to guess why? For not keeping secrets. Anyway, but so there was this group of women who had all these memories, and I learned a great deal from them. For example, the role of titanium in ritual, and the function of how the star map, in this case in Pennsylvania, functioned to get soul groups back into star inhabiting, and lots of things. It was useful. The role of titanium in ritual. Wait, let me check. Let's see. Titanium. We're using it in ritual. Titanium is a metal that's an exquisite waveguide. If you look at what the Orgone people use to do cloud busting, they take columnated pipes. And this, often it's plastic, which functions as a waveguide for microwave, effectively. And if you steer the microwave through columnated pipes set in a living river at clouds, you can make rain and bust them. But in fact, if you use titanium in that respect, it's even more powerful. And we actually use titanium in a ritual in Assisi, Italy, at an assignment by the Reverend Mothers, shaped into an ankh. It was quite a powerful moment. I can tell you about the ritual. This will just be an example. So I'm sitting at a restaurant in Buffalo, New York, and this lady comes in who's big trouble. Her name is Anne Marie Hinterberger. And the Reverend Mother says, you're supposed to take her to Italy and do a ritual at Assisi. I said, what? Well, it's a long story, but a short time later, I was invited to Italy for the second time to speak. And so we took this titanium ankh with quartz crystals sewn in the center, big thing like the titanium ankh. It was a scream, to Assisi. And we went to this grotto down below town. And this lady starts crying, and we stick this in this stone grotto under the town of Assisi, and a storm breaks up. It was like heavy-duty quivering, like snap, crackle, pop, lightning, the works. And then in her weeping, what she says was, well, fragment of the soul group of Claire, and Francis and Claire loved each other so passionately, but they never experienced passion because they didn't permit themselves touch. And the failure to touch created a magnetism in the land that was fractionated. They dreaming was stuck in the rocks because they never consumed the perspective. They never got to juiciness. And as a result, it would fail to rain. And in fact, it rained.